Hey, everybody. How are we doing? Good? Well, today I wanted to talk... Oh, I really should have turned this off. Hold on. Oh, I got to take this. Sorry, hold on. Hey, Grandma. Yeah, thanks for calling back. Yeah, so I just wanted to call and tell you, remember how last year I called you and I was all happy because I didn't have to use jQuery anymore? Yeah? Because this Angular thing has been so awesome? Well, now I get to use React in my Angular. I thought maybe you'd like to know about that. Okay. Yeah. I love you too. All right. So I usually like to start off with a joke. Today I'll do two. I was going to tell a really hilarious one, but I didn't really know how you would react. Before we talk about performance, it's important for us to talk about what is our job as engineers. Engineering, I believe, is when that which is theoretically possible through science reaches a compromise with that which is economically feasible. And this is where we find ourselves constantly tugging between the trade-offs of what's possible and what we can afford to do. Performance is really hard. It's a hard problem. In fact, this was a quote that I recently found. I don't think you are measuring what you think you are measuring. This is actually Mishko to me about this talk. Twice. Here's a question I get a lot. Is React faster than Angular? Well, the answer is very simple. That's a stupid question. I'm not going to compare apples and oranges today. Instead, I am going to build a whole new kind of superpowered frankenfruit. But first, I feel like I owe you an introduction to React. Here it is in 30 seconds. React is a web view framework in JavaScript that's designed to take your application state and allow you to write code that takes that state as input and returns virtual DOM, which is really just a set of plain old JavaScript objects, which is then passed into React's reconciling and rendering engine. And it then generates from that a set of optimized DOM operations that need to be performed on browsers to make it real. A little more detail. The performance premise of React is that the DOM is dangerously unperformant for engineers to work with directly. So instead, they give you a virtual DOM to work on, which is an intermediate representation of DOM. When your application state changes, you just render new, or you return new virtual DOM. React diffs it against the existing virtual DOM and generates performance-optimized DOM operations that will then go to the browser. It can do things like batching reads and writes, which results in fewer reflows, and it can even do cool things like generate big blocks of inner HTML for maximum speed. Here's some links I'd like you to check out later about React. So, now that you know a little bit about React, there's an obvious conclusion. React everything, right? Well, the unicorn grumpy cat says that that's really not that possible. So we're going to just react some of the things today. But first, I want to tell you a story with two parts. First part is tragedy, and the second part is glory. We'll start with the tragedy. This is a piece of UI that we developed at my company at HireVue. It's a table. It's written with Angular. It's ng-repeated. Our product managers came to us, as product managers are wont to do, and they said, please add a new column to this table. It's that one. And I thought, oh boy, we already have an ng-repeat table, and now you want us to do an ng-repeat list inside of our ng-repeat table. So I did a little bit of advanced performance mathematics, and I came up with the following. If I have a slow ng-repeat table, and I add to it a nested ng-repeat, what I get is precisely a really slow ng-repeat table. So I thought, React to the rescue, right? Here's a WAT moment. Did you guys know React stole their logo from The Simpsons? There it is. This is the attempt we thought. Let's write a directive that internally uses React to render that list of stuff so that it can be optimally fast. We'll call that directive right inside of our ng-repeat markup. Here's what happened. It's not very good. Here's why it failed. React had no ability to batch its DOM operation, so it couldn't do the one thing that it's good at. And the reason was it did not control the outer DOM. And what I mean by that is that Angular controlled the tables and rows, and then React just had to render inside of each one of those rows. So it ended up generating options like this. Append child, React. Append child, React. Append child, React. Instead of just inner HTML. Also, I should point out, ng-repeat, as we learned, is not inherently slow, and we ended up implementing this feature with a nested ng-repeat, and it was fine. Then we go forward to a year into the future. Just a few months ago, I'm going to tell you the glory part. Product management came to us again and said, please build the following. It's a schedule search algorithm. It allows users to bring up a calendar, click a search button, and then we'll start searching in their calendar for availability to do interviewing. Well, this sounded really cool. But again, I started thinking about performance. And I was concerned because we'd done apps like this before where you have a lot of things happening a lot of the time, which means you're going to have a lot of digesting. What would happen is you'd click search week, all of the cells would go into spinner mode, and then results would start coming back from the server quickly, and before we knew it, you'd have a performance challenge on your hand. We decided, we already game overed once with React. Should we insert coins to continue, or just keep our game over? We decided to insert coins, and this time, when we did Angular plus React, we got a prophetic narwhal. I'd like to show you what that looks like. Here we have some code. This is my app. Instead of showing the actual app, I've reproduced it in a minimal fashion so you can just see the relevant bits. Here we have index.html. This body consists of just two directives. One is called myCalendar, and the other is called myCalendarReact. Okay? I'd like to show you what this looks like. MyCalendar and myCalendarReact right there. Right now they're just a load button. When I click this load button, it will actually fill in the DOM to represent the calendar. But before I do that, I want to turn on the profiler. So I'm just going to hit start, load, stop, just like that. Okay, so now you can see visually what the calendar looks like. It's 24 hours tall and 31 days wide for a total of 744 cells. And here is the profile. If you haven't used Chrome's profiling tool, I'll tell you a little bit about it. The horizontal axis is time. Left is older, right is newer. The vertical axis actually represents the depth of your deepest function call stack. For the purposes of this talk, all we really care about is horizontal width. The depth isn't really that important. And I'm going to zoom in here. You can see the event handler that happened here. Whoops. And what we can see if we hover here is down below where it says aggregated total time is about 544 milliseconds. That's across all of these. Okay. Now we're going to do the same thing in our React directive. Just click the load button. I'm going to start the profiler, click load. Stop. Okay. Here you can see it did the same thing. Actually, this one was 87 milliseconds. And those numbers are a little weird. When I've run this before, it hasn't been that slow on the Angular 1 side. So I'm going to do this again just to make sure we get good representation. So start, load, stop. Okay. Yeah, that's more like it. Somewhere between 300 and 500 milliseconds. Okay. So you can see why that happened is because React was able to generate all of that DOM by doing a single inner HTML call, which is when you give a browser an inner HTML piece of HTML, it really is the fastest it can run is about that. Okay, that's one thing. Now, the next thing I want to show you is what happens when I click this search button. So what I've got here is a whole bunch of cells. Each cell is independently searchable, so I can click on it, and it simulates a trip to the server that can take up to, let's see, I think I said 10 seconds, but let me just double check. Nope, actually that's half a second. We'll do that again here. So each cell can take up to 10 seconds to do a search. You can see that 4 o'clock hour came back with 4 results, and then it just randomly generates a response with a number in it, and I can have a bunch in flight at once, and within the next 10 seconds, they'll all return with results, randomly generated, between 0 and 10 seconds. Okay? Just like that. Now, I am using $timeout to do this, so what that means is that every time a search result comes back, my root scope gets digested, which means Angular has to dirty check every single scope in my application. And since I have 744 cells inside of a nested ng-repeat, I have 744 scopes, at least, right? So that's a lot of dirty checking that it has to do in Angular 1. So let me just click this button and start the profiler. So you can see between 0 and 10 seconds, each cell is slowly trickling in its results. Okay, that's enough for now. Let me expand the profiler. Okay, so what you see here is a thick, what I like to call sequoia redwood forest with very thick trees. There are little gaps between the thick sequoia trees, and those little gaps are times when the browser is responsive to user input and the event loop isn't busy. But the times where you see the colorful areas, the trees, that is time when your JavaScript code is blocking the event loop. And if you go zoom way in here, you won't be surprised at what you find. 744 scope digests inside of each one, right? Now, this is my fault because I wrote my app this way to do a dollar timeout. Dollar timeout is not very performant because it assumes that anything could have changed, so it needs to redigest your whole app. Okay, but let's go look at the React version. So I'm going to load it, start the profiler, hit the search button. That's probably enough. And let's zoom in on that. So you can see here it's a different story, right? Instead of a forest of thick sequoia redwood trees, we have a forest of toothpicks, which is what you want to see. This space between each toothpick is time when the browser can be fully responsive to user input. So just to compare a little more carefully here, let's just pick a about a 1 second time chunk there. So this is from second 5 to second 6 on the Angular 1. And then I'll do the same thing in React. Here's a 1 second time chunk. You can see quite a big difference, right, in the amount of space between each chunk. Okay? All right, so that's how that looks. By the way, I could have done some more optimization to make the Angular 1 app look more like this, but I didn't because by default, we're going to be using dollar timeout, and this is the kind of thing you're going to have to debug. But let me just show you what the code looks like. So here's my app file. The Angular 1 code you should be really familiar with. This is a common pattern here. We have our myCalendar directive. Inside the myCalendar directive, I have a nested ng-repeat. And then inside that nested ng-repeat, I have a myCalendar cell directive, which is declared a little bit down here. And each myCalendar cell has just a couple of ng-ifs inside of it to decide what state to show and what should go in there. Okay, just like that, pretty straightforward. Now, if I scroll down below the calendar cell one, I'll show you the directive that has React inside of it. So myCalendarReact was the name of the directive, which you'll remember from the HTML. And here's its link function, which just does one thing. It says react.render, and then this weird thing. Does anybody know what that is? Has anyone seen that before? This is called JSX, and it is not JavaScript. It is a way to easily represent HTML right inside of your JavaScript. And this thing is actually a React component, which I'll scroll down and show you what it looks like. So here I have a calendar component. React generates, or you declare a React component by saying react.create class. Every React component should have a render function, and the render function returns a bunch of HTML. Now, it looks pretty template-y, but notice we're still in our JavaScript file. This HTML is actually not returning DOM. This HTML, or this stuff that looks like HTML, is actually returning virtual DOM. And this gets compiled by React's JSX compiler and into a different kind of JavaScript that actually will execute in the browser. Okay, so you can see here, this is my calendar. My calendar is just like my Angular calendar. It is, instead of using ng-repeat, we actually use array.map. So here I've got an array.map over the hours and an array.map over the days. And inside here I've got a cell component that I've written. And the cell component is another React class with its own render function that has a couple of if statements and returns different HTML depending on the state of the cell. Okay, just like that. All right. So that's how that's actually how easy it is to integrate a React component into an Angular directive. But let me show you what happens when we speed things up a bit. So right now we saw with a 10-second random timeout on each cell what it looks like. If I make that closer to half a second, you can really start to feel what things look like from a user's perspective. So let's load up the Angular one, hit search. Now remember, I made it a half a second timeout, so all of these should be done in half a second. You can see it's cooking along. Actually, I think this is not, I think that might have been cached. Let me try again. That doesn't look right. Let's go with a new tab. Huh. Maybe that's right. It seems awfully slow. Let me restart. Wait for it. That seems really slow to me, but we'll just go with it. Let me show you the React one. Just like that. Let me do that again, in case you didn't see it. You had to be watching, okay? So that's the difference there is not digesting the whole world, because in the React app, it was easily, by default, the design is to only really digest the things you need to, although it doesn't have a digest. And in fact, the RootScope digest didn't run at all inside the React directive. So there you go. Okay, so that's kind of the difference. All right, so let's go back to the slides here. There are drawbacks to using React. First of all, you will add 500 kilobytes of code to your app. It is not a tiny library. Secondly, you must have a JSX build step. You can write React without JSX, but I don't recommend it. Thirdly, you now have two frameworks in your app. Now, this is a problem because you have people to train, you have developers who won't know one or the other, and now they might have to know both, so it can be a problem. Lastly, you might very well have to change your internationalization. We did. We support 14 languages, and we had to use a very different internationalization pattern with React than we did with Angular. React, however, does shine. In the initial DOM load, it does really well because it can batch all of the operations to generate it really quickly. And this is mostly thanks to things like inner HTML. Also, after small state changes, React is really good about only touching the parts of the DOM that actually changed. And it is even really good when there's big changes in the DOM because it can bulk do those too. React's kind of weak after there are no state changes. If you tell React to re-render your whole app, it will generate all of the new virtual DOM. And in my experience, it takes about twice as long to generate all the virtual DOM for an app of significant size than it does to run through the digest dirty check once. For an app I was testing with, for example, you can get 13 milliseconds versus about 27 milliseconds in React, which you might think is insignificant, except 27 is greater than the 60 FPS boundary, which is 16 milliseconds. And so it does make a difference. One of the strategies I use is to not tell the whole app to re-render, but rather find the components that have changed and tell those to re-render. So that's pretty much all I wanted to show you about React, but I do have one more thing that I wanted to show you. I did actually build the app in Angular 2. Thanks a lot to the Angular team for helping me get this working. And I just wanted to show you what that looks like. So first of all, I'm going to hit the load button. That's actually really fast, if you didn't see that. Now I'm going to hit the search button. So you will want to be watching for this because remember, here's how it looked like with React. Just pay attention how long it took. This is React. Okay. And here's Angular 2. Angular 2 is really, really fast. So you have to do your own engineering. You need to measure, observe, and decide for your team. Thanks very much.
Hey, everybody. You may have noticed a mistake that I made in my talk when I was comparing the performance of Angular 2 and the React example. The problem was that in my Angular 2 example, the random millis function was written to return 0, while the React function at the time was written to return a random number between 0 and 500. So it's really not a fair comparison to show the run times of the two frameworks when one of them is set up to return more slowly. I'm really sorry about that. It was completely accidental. Now I want to make it right and show you what it looks like when both frameworks are set up to return a 0 millisecond timeout. So here is the React example. And I'm not even going to run the profiler. I'm just going to let you see it visually. So I'm going to click the Search All Month button. Okay. And here is the Angular 2 example. To my eye, the Angular 2 example does look a little bit faster for this particular example, but it's worth mentioning that the Angular team actually helped me optimize this, and the React team hasn't had a chance to look at this at all. I wouldn't make any kind of conclusion about the relative performance of these two frameworks from this example, but I at least wanted to show that I did make a mistake, and I did make the performance difference look more significant than it really was. So I apologize for that, and thanks for being patient with me as I work on performance. Like I said in my talk, performance is hard, and what I didn't say in my talk is that I'm a gigantic idiot, and you probably shouldn't listen to anything I say anyway.